This is Norseman with survivology101.com. What I wanted to do is discuss the plant edibility test with you. I know that this video is going to generate a whole lot of questions, so wherever you happen to see it, because it will get posted in multiple locations, please go back to the blog post on survivology101.com and post your questions there so that I can answer them in a timely manner and not try and track down all the different questions all over the web. And read the questions that were answered first before you post yours, because I may have already answered it. So thanks, and enjoy the video. Okay, my intent was to shoot a quick video discussing the edibility plant test. Unfortunately, that's not possible to shoot it quick. I decided to do it here in my garage studio instead of out in the field, so I have as minimal distractions as possible. And I have some note material and some references here so that so I don't give you some bad information. I was in a fortunate position that I got invited to a workshop at the Air Land Sea Application Center for the Air Force at Langley to update and revise the FM3TEC 50.3, which is a small SEER manual that goes in pilots' ejection seats. And it's got a lot of really good bulleted information in it without all the extra fluff that you would find in the regular survival manual. Unfortunately, it's limited distribution and you can't get it, so don't ask. While there, I met a gentleman named Vern Page, who's a survivalist from way back. And he developed a new version of the plant edibility test. He wrote a point paper for the U.S. Air Force on it to have it included, and we talked at length about it, and I tried everything I could do to debunk this and get it removed from the book, because I never liked the idea of just randomly chomping on plants. But Mr. Page has covered about every angle I could imagine, and I've talked to other SEER instructors and other tops in their field, and everybody seems to agree that we can't seem to find any serious loopholes in this other than somebody using it incorrectly, which is always a possibility. What I'll cover is the test itself, the considerations for the test, which is kind of a pretest, and that's where you can really go wrong if you're not paying attention. Some supporting information that he gathered for the point paper, and a few of the tests that he actually did personally with this, a few of the plant materials and what the outcome was for his test. There's also a section, it's a 20-page point paper, there's also a section in there that covers some more common plants or common poisonous bulbs and what their likelihood is of passing the test. So this is the point paper. And it starts off with obviously a cover page. The next page is the preface, which I am going to read to you. And it says, the United States Air Force Survival Evasion Resistance and Escape School has long been the leader in providing quality instruction for preparing air crew with the SEER skills and knowledge required for global environments. In the process of improving instruction, numerous changes and valued additions have been made. Some additions, however, can add unnecessary complexity to instruction, resulting in a decline in student learning. This has been the case with the SEER plant edibility test. There are now several versions of the edibility test printed in both Air Force SEER and Joint Military SEER instructional manuals. These versions often contain confusing language and in some cases inaccurate information. Clearly, an accurate, easy-to-follow, standardized revision is needed. This paper will present a SEER plant edibility test that, one, that is medically sound, two, botanically accurate, three, simple to understand, and four, easy to retain and apply in a long-term life-and-death survival or captivity situation. And it's signed by a U.S. Air Force colonel who I won't mention. Now, the purpose of this paper is they've traced out the background pretty far back. I'll go into that in a second, but it's to kind of get everybody on the same page. If you go on YouTube, you'll find a lot of videos that cover this particular test, but nothing none of them are consistent. And the idea is to be consistent. And that's why Vern let me do this video, is so that people can start getting consistent and teaching the same thing. Because the goal is survival. Okay, what it's going to cover is the plant types and structures that should be tested, plant types that should not be tested, helpful hints and cautions when testing, and a simple, safe, and easy to remember test procedure. So it takes a little pre-study. The background. In researching the origins of the plant edibility rules, the earliest U.S. manual found was the War Department's Technical Manual TM-10, TAC 420, Emergency Food Plants and Poisonous Plants of the Islands of the Pacific, which was prepared for U.S. troops fighting in the jungles of the Pacific during World War II. The earliest Air Force manual found was Air Force Manual 64-5, Air Force Survival Manual, dated 1952. Both of these had different versions of the test, and the oldest version was simply take a mouthful, chew it up, hold it in your mouth for 5 minutes. If the taste is still agreeable after 5 minutes, swallow it. And if it's not, then don't continue. And then it goes on with some other various recommendations and things you should test, and warning against fungi and things of that nature. But that was basically the original test, which isn't very good. And it was designed for people who are in a POW camp chained to a pole. But unfortunately, people are trying to take this out into survival training scenarios that they go on every day or camping, and trying to use these techniques, and they're just not accurate. Okay, so the point paper goes on to explain the similarities and differences between the two manuals, and other sources. And obviously that's endless if you consider all the books on the shelf at the various bookstores or available online. Seems like everybody wants to tweak it and have their own little spin on it. Okay, there's a little bit more information and a little graph on that shows kind of the similarities and differences between some different military publications that use it, and then it goes into the SEER plant edibility test, okay, or the pre-test area of it, and I'll go through and I'll read that, and I'll also post it up here. When to test an unknown plant. Long-term survival situations for the purpose of maintaining life. Number two, selecting a plant. Test the starchy parts of the plant like grains, seeds, rootstocks, and bulbs. Test fruit for sweetness. Test berries that are black, blue, or red. Never test white, green, or yellowish berries. Test leaves and stems from plants growing in the shade and in moist soil. Test only plants available in sufficient supply. It doesn't really do a lot of good to waste a bunch of hours on a plant test if there's only two or three of them around. You want stuff that's obviously enough to sustain you for a while you continue to test other plants in the vicinity. Keep your digestive system clean when testing. Start with an 8-hour empty stomach. Test only one plant part at a time and drink only purified water during the test. Now some people might say, oh, 8 hours, and then you got 8 hours in the test and all this other time frames. I've run enough survival courses to know that when you're out there and you don't have a reliable food source, 8 hours without food is not a big stretch. Most students will end up with multiple days without food, and even if they know a couple of plants. So the 8-hour without food stretch is not as uncommon or hard to do as you might think. It's going to happen naturally. Cautions. Never assume a raw plant is edible because the cooked plant you tested was edible. Cooking often destroys certain toxins. If you doubt that, that's the case with stinging nettle. You can't even barely touch the stuff, but if you cook it, it destroys the toxin, and it's actually quite edible, and it tastes pretty good. Never assume the entire plant is edible because one part of the plant is edible. There are a lot of plants that have edible and medicinal and poisonous parts all on the same plant. Never assume a plant is edible for humans because you observe an animal eating the same plant. Their physiology is different and they process things differently, so take that into consideration. Nicotine users should be cautious using taste to identify toxins because tobacco use reduces their sensitivity to a number of specific toxins. It's got a side note down here that comes from the Department of the Air Force, Regulation 64-4, Survival Training, Volume 1, 15 July 1985, page number 236. Reactions to a poisonous plant may include tingling, burning, numbing, redness, itching, swelling, pain, cramping, vomiting, diarrhea, nervousness, dizziness, drowsiness, eye sensitivity to light, and potentially death, of course. And nausea and lethargy. The test itself. I'll read it right from the top. Plant edibility test. Remember it as the rules of eight. We all like those rules of threes, rules of whatever. Rules of eight. Your senses can identify an unknown plant's edibility. Sight. First look for plant parts that contain high energy. Fruit, seeds, grains, and nuts, roots, bulbs, and tubers. And never test fungi, i.e. mushrooms and mold, seeds in pods, i.e. beans and peas, plants with umbrella-shaped flowers, dill, hemlock, fennel, plants with milky sap, like poinsettia, poison oak, those kind, and shiny, glossy, leafy plants, like many tropical houseplants, and again, poison oak. Now, the never test criteria will rule out a lot of edibles, but it'll also rule out the majority of non-edibles. So if you understand the plant, like a plant with milky sap, it would be a dandelion. It has milky sap, it's delicious. So really, the test is no replacement for actual plant knowledge. But if that's all you got, then it's all you got. The second part, smell. So we're going from the eyes to the nose. If any unpleasant odor is present, stop the test. If there's a moldy or a musty smell, stop the test. If there is an unusual smell, just something that just doesn't smell right, like, what's that one? They call it Hell's Bells, Jimson Weed. It's got a few other names. It's a big white trumpet flower. That thing just reeks. So you wouldn't want to test it. And almond scent. If there's an almond scent, stop the test. Okay, we go from the smell to the skin. Place the juice of the plant on the outer lip for 8 minutes. So just take a little bit of the juice and put it right here. We're going away from the doing it on your arm and in the pit of your arm and all those other different places. Just a little bit on the outside of your lip for 8 minutes. Remember, rule of eight. If reaction occurs, stop the test. If no reaction occurs, move on to the taste test. For the taste test, taste a small amount of the plant juice. So that little bit, just a little bit, put it in your mouth. Chew a pinch of the plant and leave it in the mouth for 8 minutes. Do not swallow the juice or your spit. If an unpleasant taste or reaction occurs, stop the test. If no reaction occurs, swallow it. And now we're into the digestive system. So we went eye, nose, lip, inside the mouth, and digestive system. It all flows logically and sequentially. Digestive system. After swallowing, wait 8 hours. If no reaction occurs, then chew a handful of the plant, you know, a little more than you did the first time, swallow, and wait 8 hours. If no reaction occurs, consider the tested plant part edible. That is what is being printed now. That is what's going in the manuals across the board, and you heard it here first. Okay, so after that portion is done, the point paper goes on a little bit farther, and it goes on to justify changing the old procedure. Reasons why we need to change it and inconsistencies between them and things that are just flat wrong in all the old procedures. There's a few pages of that. Okay, and then it goes into some appendices. Poisonous plant bulbs of the world. Because remember, the bulb was one of the parts of the plant that has the most nourishment, so that's one of the ones you want to test. So what this covers is, I'm not going to read the whole document, but I will cover the plants themselves with the poisonous bulbs, the toxins that they contain on some of them, and the symptoms of those toxins. That's all in here. What I'll cover is the plant and why it would fail the test. So, lily of the Nile. The bulb would not pass the skin or mouth test. Skin irritation is minor or lasting only for a few minutes, but it would not pass the test. South African belladonna lily or naked ladies. Symptoms are nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. The bulb would not pass the digestive system test. Jack in the pulpit. The bulb would not pass the skin or the mouth test. Kaffir lily. Bulb would not pass the digestive system test. Meadow saffron. The bulb would not pass the taste, mouth, or digestive system test. Spider lily. The bulb would not pass the digestive system test. Crocus. Bulb would not pass the skin or the mouth test. Daffodils. The bulb would not pass the digestive system test. Snowdrop. The bulb would not pass the taste or digestive system test. Golden hurricane lily. The bulb would not pass the digestive system test. Star of Bethlehem. The bulb would not pass the taste, mouth, or digestive system test. Tulips. Poisonous tulip bulbs would not pass the taste test or digestive system test. And red squill. The bulb would not pass the mouth test or the digestive system test. That's why, I don't know if the other parts of the plant would. I assume not, because it's really the same toxin. It's just more concentrated in the bulb. But you would want to test the bulb anyway, because the bulb is the part that contains the most nutrient. Obviously not of those plants if you can identify them, but of unidentified plants. You have zephyr lily. The bulb would not pass the digestive system test. And death camas. Yeah, that one's the one that everybody seems to want to point to. And they got a whole separate appendix on that one. And I'll read you that whole thing. One of the most commonly stated examples of a poisonous wild bulb is the death camas. Death camas contains poisonous bitter alkaloids, including zigzagnosine and, I don't know, some other medical term. Species are found both in North and Central America and Eurasia. Fortunately, these alkaloids are easily detected by human taste. The author has experienced this several times in testing. This species throughout the Pacific Northwest. After having gathered and prepared some edible camas, he bit into a death camas that was accidentally included in the batch of edibles. Immediately knew that it was by its extreme bitter taste and spit it out. Human poisoning from death camas are rare. Note, a side note, that comes from Turner, N.J. Zashansky. Common poisonous plants and mushrooms of North America, Timber Press, 1991, page 107. In the unlikely event a person eats several of these bitter bulbs, nausea and vomiting would result as a warning and a safeguard. Data extrapolated from animal ingestion of death camas indicate that it would take a pound, which is 40 to 50 bulbs, to be fatal to a human adult. The name death camas is therefore overstated. A more accurate description, descriptive name would be poison camas. And that data about 40 to 50 bulbs comes from Wagstaff, DJ, and Case, AA, Human Poisoning by Zagendinus, 1987, volume 25, number 4, pages 361 to 367. So it's referenced. Let's see. And then it goes on in the appendix, and it tells a little bit more about bulbs in Native American history. And then there's another appendix that has some plants that were actually tested by the author and what the result of that testing was, and I'll cover that briefly. The plant name, poison hemlock. On the skin test, 17 minutes, no reaction. Lip test, 17 minutes, no reaction. Taste test, 8 to 10 seconds, no reaction. Mouth test, 17 minutes, no reaction. Type of toxin, an alkaloid. But it would not have passed the initial criteria of being an umbrella-shaped flower. Water hemlock. Again, wouldn't pass the initial criteria, but he tested it anyway. 17 minutes, no reaction on the skin test. 17 minutes, no reaction on the skin and lip test. Taste test, 8 to 10 seconds, no reaction. And the mouth test, 45 minutes, produced a tingling that lasted 13 plus hours. And again, it's an alkaloid. It's a real rare toxin on this one. Apple seeds, 15 minutes, no reaction on the skin test. The first skin test, I'm sorry, was on the wrist, the old way, and the second skin test is on the lip. So, the second skin test, 15 minutes, no reaction. The taste test, 8 to 10 seconds, a bitter almond taste. The mouth test, 3 to 4 minutes, light nervous tingling feeling. Snowberry. Skin test on the wrist, 15 minutes, no reaction. Skin test on the lip, 15 minutes, no reaction. Taste test, 8 to 10 seconds, kind of sweet and bitter. Mouth test, 1 to 2 minutes, tingling and pain. Yarrow, which we all know has medicinal purposes, 15, and again, for medicinal purposes, yarrow still got that umbrella-shaped flower, so you probably wouldn't want to test it for food unless you already know what it is for medicinal purposes. 15 minutes, no reaction on the skin test on the wrist. 15 minutes, no reaction, skin test on the lip. 8 to 10 seconds, no reaction on the taste test. And 90 seconds of, after 90 seconds of tingling, and then 3 minutes numbing. And it's got several different toxic compounds in it. And the last one tested was skunk cabbage. Skin test on the wrist, 15 minutes, no reaction. Skin test on the lip, 15 minutes, no reaction. Taste test, 8 to 10 seconds, no reaction. And 3.5 minutes of tingling on the mouth test. 3.5 minutes tingling, 5 minutes a needle-like pain. So that's the whole point paper. That's the whole thing. Remember, this was one of the source documents that showed one of the methods that's pretty commonly used nowadays. It's been changed slightly. And this is the other document that was referenced in the point paper. I hope that you'll actually realize how complicated it is to safely test plants and go out and actually learn them. The method that I prefer is to learn it one plant at a time. Start with your area, start with the most prominent plants, do a little research and figure out which ones are available around the world in all environments, and start learning those plants. Learn them in all their stages of growth, through all the seasons of the year. You can learn one plant in the summer when you know it pretty good, learn another plant that summer, learn another plant, and then go back through the other seasons and learn those same plants over and over so you know them through their entire growth cycle. That's the way to be successful. Once you get a pocket full of plants that are available around the world, then you have no worries. If you get a pocket full of plants that are available around the entire world, then you probably shouldn't even need this edibility test, but it's there. And that's the new revision. That's what I got for you. If you want to post questions, like I said, go back to survivology101.com and post the questions on the blog so that I can answer them, because I'm not going to be able to answer them wherever this video turns up. Well, I hope you enjoyed the video. I know there's not a lot of action here. If you're going to post a comment, please do it on survivology101.com on the blog page so that I can get there and answer it, because I can't answer it all the different places this video will turn up. And remember that survival is a discipline of attitude, knowledge, skills, and actions. Survival is not mandatory.